We docked between warships. Two trailers arrived and Libyan soldiers formed a chain to unload the cargo onto the Excellent. One of the soldiers asked me if I wanted arms as well as the ammunition. I don't know what to say just to get out of the situation, so I said yes. He offered me various arms, mortars, AK-47s, flamethrowers and surface-to-air missiles. The following night we returned and 100 more boxes were unloaded. And we set sail for the IRA.
What was your reaction to the seizure of the Excellent?
One of surprise, I think, and initially of relief, because here a large supply of arms had been seized, and all these rockets and Semtex explosives and small arms had been seized and were not therefore going to be used in the war by the IRA.
A sense of jubilation in terms of a capture like that being made. And the blow it would strike at the provisional IRA in terms of equipping itself.
In France, the questioning of Adrian Hopkins, skipper of the Exxon, continued. It was day two of his interrogation.
Did I know the Exxon was to deliver arms? Certainly not. I have absolutely no knowledge of it.
Meanwhile, as Hopkins started to sing in France, along the Irish border, preparations for the Enniskillen attack were almost complete. The operation was complex and tightly coordinated.
It was an organized effort between a number of units, north and south of the border.
How many units?
I would suspect possibly three units were involved.
Which were?
We believe that the South East Fermanagh unit, with some assistance from Monaghan, provided the electronic timer. The Donegal, South West Fermanagh, prepared the bomb.
According to British and Irish intelligence sources, the planned attack wasn't the work of renegade IRA units. An operation against such an iconic and emotional target involving units from both sides of the border could only have been carried out with sanction from on high. And that meant a green light from the men who ran the long war in the north, the IRA's Northern Command.
Did Northern Command approve the attacks?
Northern Command had a knowledge of the attack prior to it taking place.
Which means they gave their approval to it, presumably, if they had knowledge of it.
They didn't stop it.
I would be very surprised if they were not aware that attacks were going to be carried out on certain centres, towns or targets. So in essence, I would be surprised if they weren't aware that there was going to be an attack in Enniskillen.
Leading Republicans challenged this view. Former IRA prisoner Danny Morrison was Sinn Féin's director of publicity at the time.
I don't believe that the attack was organised by or sanctioned, or that the leadership of the Republican movement was privy to it.
But if you have different IRA units from both sides of the border involved in this operation, that must imply that it was sanctioned at high level. The high level would be Northern Command.
You're saying this, and I'm saying, how do you know this? And then when I ask you how you know it, you says you can't tell me.
Are you saying it's not true?
I'm saying I don't know. How can I comment?
British and Irish intelligence sources both told me that the leading figure on Northern Command at the time was Martin McGuinness, now Northern Ireland's Deputy First Minister. I put this to Mr. McGuinness. He said he was not a member of Northern Command and had no prior knowledge of Enniskillen. Nearly 500 miles away, on the third day of his interrogation, Adrian Hopkins finally dropped any pretense that he was an innocent abroad.
Actually, Appleton, now, I haven't been telling you the truth. I was afraid for my life. The actual facts are as follows. Three years ago, Keynes, who I knew, contacted me. I thought he was IRA. He suggested we use a yacht I owned to transport arms from the Mediterranean. Due to my financial difficulties at the time, I agreed, as I was being paid an awful lot of money. Through Keynes, I met a man called Maliki. We discussed the conditions. 5 tons of arms to be transported. In return, I would be paid £100,000.
Why do you think Adrian Hopkins did it?
A need.
A need for what?
I'd say for money.
Not through any commitment to the IRA's cause?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Adrian Hopkins now dropped a bombshell that was to make the Brits' hair stand on end. The Exund was not the only vessel he'd sailed to Libya. He revealed that over the last 2 years, he'd already landed 4 other Libyan shipments in Ireland.
In all, during these 4 voyages, between 100 and 130 tons of arms and ammunition were brought into the country. Cargo was unloaded on the Irish coast, a place called Clogger Strand.
This was an intelligence failure of monumental proportions. How could 4 shipments have slipped through the net? British and Irish intelligence had utterly failed to clock Hopkins at his regular commute to Libya. And there were some glaring clues. In January 1986, after Hopkins' first trip, the Irish police had uncovered 2 arms dumps.
And in those 2 searches were found over 80 AK-47s and other weaponry. Pistols, I think, were also found in those 2 searches. But one clear issue in all of this is that there was a box which said Libyan army weaponry, or words to that effect, which was quite obvious that they had come at some stage from Libya.
It said Libyan armed forces, I think.
Well, that's fairly specific, isn't it, Peter? Libyan armed forces. So I do think, and I think we've all accepted, that it was a serious breakdown in our intelligence gathering system at the time.
That's probably an understatement.
Understatement.
In the course of my research, I've seen an intelligence document. It's marked secret and personal. It reveals the scale of the weaponry that Adrian Hopkins had already landed in Ireland before the interception of the Exund. The arsenal included 36 rocket launchers, 10 SAM 7s, 26 heavy machine guns, hundreds of rifles, thousands of rounds of ammunition, over 200 grenades, 10 flamethrowers, and enough Semtex explosive to blow things up for years to come. The secret document also reveals that the Libyans paid around £10 million into the IRA's coffers, all in cash. For the British, this translated into more dead soldiers, more dead policemen, and more dead bystanders. And a nightmare that could endure for years.
There was a reaction of alarm when we discovered that this was not the only shipment and that there had been previous shipments. And so there was a large arsenal hidden somewhere in the Republic or wherever, which could be used by the IRA so that the long war, in the military sense, could go on for a very long time.
Did that shock you?
Yes.
The sense of jubilation in terms of the interception of the Exund changed very, very quickly to a cold sense of realization. You may have got the Exund, but 130 plus tons of weaponry have already come into the Republic of Ireland for use by the IRA.
It became quite clear to IRA volunteers on the ground that the IRA had successfully landed an incredible number of arms, and that it had enough supply possibly to maintain the armed struggle at a fair tempo for possibly the next 20, 25 years.
As the British came to terms with the enormity of Hopkins's revelations, the Enniskillen operation was nearing its climax. On Saturday, the 7th of November, the 50-pound bomb was taken to its target under cover of darkness.
We believe that sometime on the Saturday early evening, it was moved to the outskirts of Enniskillen, scouted in by members of the local provisional IRA unit.
Scouted in?
Yeah. Members would have taken positions along the route to ensure that no security forces were present. A number of local provisional IRA sympathisers were in Enniskillen, deployed to keep a lookout for members of the security forces.
Towards midnight, the caretaker of a social club known as the Reading Rooms was playing cards with a couple of friends before he locked up. As they dealt the last hand, they thought they heard faint, muffled footsteps upstairs. The bomb was being placed against the gable wall of the building. The wall looked onto the cenotaph where the wreath-laying ceremony was due to start the following morning.
The Enniskillen bomb was a homemade explosive device constructed of fertiliser-based explosive, which was placed, we believe, against the gable wall, which abutted the footpath next to the war memorial. A detonation was through using an electronic timer set to go off at 10:43 in the morning of the Remembrance Day.
I mean, my first memory of that morning was watching cricket on my TV. And my mother came into the bedroom and I just said to her, you know, do I have to go this morning? I don't really want to go. You know, you make your dad happy if you go, she said to me. You know, we'll both go together, okay? So we did.
We were having a family day. And Serena, our youngest daughter, head girl of the school, she was there to lay the wreath.
My husband and my youngest daughter, Mary, had planned to go down to the war memorial in Enniskillen. I, as usual, had planned to go to the Methodist church to begin playing the organ before the parade would come to the church.
We set off, as usual, to go to the Remembrance Day parade, and me and my father actually were standing in the crowd, just taking all in of meeting different people that were there that you would have seen. You mightn't have seen them for a year, but you'd always kind of bump into them on Remembrance Sunday.
Gordon and Mary left to go to the war memorial.
Do you remember saying goodbye to her that morning?
I remember it very clearly. I was in the kitchen and she came hurrying through, rushed out the back door and said, "Bye, Mum." And I called after her and said, "Mary, do you have an umbrella?" And she said, "Of course I have, Mum. Don't fuss."